Yeah, it's nice to be here. My name is Stefan Cooks. I'm from Slockit. You see blockchains on the screen. So as maybe some of you know, Slockit was acquired from blockchains last year. And that's why we are connected with blockchains now. And so actually we are the technical arm developing the products which are developed with blockchains. So today I want to talk a little bit about Incubed and what Incubed can do for the ecosystem of blockchains, especially now, of course, for Ethereum, but also for other blockchains. So when we have applications where we need blockchain, for instance, IoT, this is where we from Slockit started. So who knows Slockit knows we started with building logs, which are controlled with a smart contract so that you can pay to access the store log. And we also did a lot of other IoT, for instance, when you build a smart meter, for instance, and want to send and receive data from the blockchain, you need a connection to the blockchain. So in the beginning, we started with experimenting with light clients. So how can we bring interoperability with the blockchain into IoT devices? And this is a really tough thing because most IoT devices are very small, microcontrollers and so on. And it's very hard or impossible to run normal synchronizing clients on it. Another problem is when you have a mobile app. Of course, in a mobile app, you can run a light client. You can ask Ligi what happens when you run a light client in a mobile app. It's not an easy task because you have a lot of energy consumption. It consumes or needs a lot of traffic. So it's not a good way to have it in your mobile app. Or a web page. If you have a web page, it's not really possible to run a client in a web page. Of course, you can connect to a service where you run the client, or you can run a client on the computer. But if you have only a web page and want to deliver it to people and want them to access directly data from the blockchain, it's not possible at all. So, and then we started working on IoT devices at Slockit. We had exact these challenges. How to solve the problem to get secure blockchain information into small devices. So when Ethereum started, then this was the vision. To have a decentralized network which is connected peer-to-peer, and we have some decentralized application which are connected to clients and work in this way, completely decentralized, no single point of failures, and so on. But this is how it looks like mostly at this time. We have centralized services to access the decentralized world. It's a very important bridge technology, of course. It's nice to have this technology, or that we had this technology in the past, so that we can build decentralized applications. But thinking a little bit in the future, this is not a good way. So we need a complete decentralized way to interact with blockchain, even if you are in small devices or in applications which cannot afford to synchronize all the time. So when we talk about clients, so in the Ethereum world, of course, I can run a full node which synchronizes. So at the moment, it's about 235-240 gigabytes, which you need on your disk. If you synchronize from the beginning, it takes a while. Even if you use a light or a quick sync mechanism, it takes always some minutes, hours to synchronize. Even if you have a light client where you only synchronize the block header information, it takes minutes or even hours to get this information. And now think about a small device, like a door lock, which is on a place where it's very bad internet connection, and the door lock has only a small battery inside. You cannot afford to synchronize with a light client or a full node. So what most applications do in the moment, as I said, is using a remote client. Meaning you have an internet node where you run your full node and then use RPC connection to get information. But what happens? So we have two big problems in this when we use it like this. So the first is we have a single point of failure. If the service shuts down or it's not available, then you have a problem. And I think this is even more important, it's not secure. The client cannot check by itself that the information it receives is correct. If there's a man-in-the-middle attack, I can try to prevent it by encryption, but yeah, the client itself has no clue how to do or how to check this information. So, and what we did with Incubed is to build a client which is as lightweight as a remote client, but is able to check and validate all the information like a light client without synchronizing the information directly from the blockchain. Of course, and this is, I think, always important, that sounds a little bit too good to be true, it solves not all problems. This is not a solution for every problem, of course, but for a lot of problems, it is a really good solution. If you have an application which needs from time to time information from the blockchain, this is a very good solution. If you need synchronized information all the time, for instance, you need to connect or need to read events all the time, then probably the Incubed client is not the best solution for it. But for most applications, so as I said, we are coming from the IoT world. There, mostly we need from time to time information, and we need it in a secure way. And then the Incubed client is a very good solution. So, and with Incubed, it looks like this. I try to touch nothing. Okay, so with Incubed, it looks a little bit like this. We have this peer-to-peer network where our full nodes running connected peer-to-peer as we know it. And some of these nodes run also the Incubed server software. This is only a small software which connects the full node to the internet to the Incubed protocol. And the Incubed nodes, they are connected to the network of these Incubed nodes. And by this way, we have a decentralized network. And I will also explain how these nodes or how these clients are able to validate the information by themselves. So first, a short definition. So we called it a minimal verification client. That means a client which needs the minimum in resources and is able to verify all the information. So verification means it needs to check if the information is correct and belongs to a correct block of the blockchain. This we need to validate in our client. So and the important thing from Incubed is that we have a complete stateless client which doesn't need to synchronize, as I said. It's not a part of the peer-to-peer network. So we don't need any other information than only one information we get when we ask such a node. And with this information, we can do all the verifications. Okay, how is it working? I try to explain it a little bit so that you get a clue how others can use this protocol or use these clients. So the first thing is our registry. This is a smart contract running on the blockchain, and full nodes can register in this registry. They have to give some metadata, how they can be accessed, and also they have to give it a security deposit. I will explain why we need this later. And the Incubed clients, they can synchronize this list of available nodes. And with this list, they know which nodes they can access. So now, when we have a client, and this client needs information. Now it has this list, and in this list it sees, okay, in this case it has 5 nodes. These nodes have a security deposit, and they have also a rating. So it knows, okay, when I talk to this, it's probably a good one, or this is not a good one, because he didn't answer me the last times. So then it selects one node and sends an RPC request. This is almost the same like I would do with a normal remote client. But as response, I not only receive the result of my request, but also do I receive the Merkle proof for this data and the block header. And with this information, I can validate by myself in this moment that this information belongs to this block because I have numerical proof. And this is also possible in very small devices. It's a little bit calculation, but not that much. So at this moment, we have the sure information, okay, we can be sure this information belongs to this block, but I don't know if this block is really a block of the blockchain. It could be a manipulated block, which is good in for itself, but is not belonging to the blockchain. That's why we also need to ask other nodes. So and the client now has a list, and he selects other nodes and asks them for a validation. What means validation? He asks them to sign the block hash of the block which was delivered by node B. So, and when we have this information, then we know, okay, we have a block. This block belongs to the blockchain because others have signed it. And we know that our information belongs to the block. So, and what happens if some of these nodes are misbehaving, signing from block hashes? Because this is the information we rely on. So our legacy smart contract has the ability to convict nodes which are misbehaving. So the block hash is the only information I can validate on-chain in the past, at least a little bit in the past. And that means when someone finds a signed block hash, which is not correct, which is not belong to the blockchain, then he can go to the registry, convict this node, and he loses his deposit, and he's thrown out of the network. So that means for the client, when he has the need for a request of the value of maybe 100 euro, then he can select nodes to validate his or this request, which have a deposit which is higher than the value of this transaction or of this request. And so I have a crypto economic incentive to get the correct information. So I can decide how secure I need the information, because when I need more security, then I can select other nodes with higher deposits or more nodes so that I have the security I need. And also, I can put active watchdogs into the network. So when I think, okay, maybe the network is a little bit compromised, there maybe are some nodes which are working together and trying to misbehave or to betray me, then I can run such a watchdog, which is there. And this watchdog acts like an Enqubit client, but has the connection to the blockchain. And so by it, he knows by himself, okay, this is the correct information. And when he receives a wrong information, he can directly convict it in the registry. And with this, we have a network which is completely decentralized, because the client doesn't need to talk always to the same node. And actually, in the protocol, we have a rule that the client should not talk to the same client, to the same node twice in the row, because then he could be maybe censored, because the other node knows now he asks, for instance, how much I have to pay to open the lock. And when then the transaction comes that I pay for it, he can censor it and I cannot get access. So, but if I select always a random node to talk with, then this danger is not appearing. So when we see these nodes, they have to deliver information, and if they misbehave, they lose their deposit. That's not a good business model. You have money, you can lose it, but the only thing what you do is being good and nothing happens. That's why we are working also on an incentive layer, which means that a client can ask for information and pays directly for this information. And so the nodes can have a business model. They are incentivized to offer this service, and the client is paying for it. It's a very, very small amount. And we're also working on flat models so that they bundle requests so that it's easy to handle. This is not yet finished. The other protocol is completely finished. And on last Wednesday, we released the stable version. It's stable on Ethereum mainnet. It's usable now. The incentive layer will be the next step, which we will release during the beginning of this year. So as I said, this happens, or this works, of course, with one blockchain, for instance, public Ethereum. But our client is not storing any state. That means he can talk also to other blockchains, for instance, a private chain or even Bitcoin. So we are working also on a protocol enhancement so that we can also validate Bitcoin transactions. So then you have only one client, which serves as interface to Ethereum and all other blockchains. And if you run it, for instance, on your small device, you only need one client and can interact with all these blockchains. So, and not even only blockchains, so all verifiable data services. Now, for instance, IPFS is, of course, one simple example. It's already working. The client can also interact with IPFS or with any other service where a proof for the validity of the data can be provided. Yeah, we have several versions there. There is the smallest one, the nano version, which is small enough to run on a real microcontroller. So maybe I have one here. If you see, so here in the middle, this black chip, this microcontroller is enough to run this client completely. So then we have the basic version, which can interact with state and so on. And also the full version, which can also do the interactions with the EVM. So we have a complete EVM included in this protocol. So as I said, last Wednesday we had the stable release of the first kind of productive version. And so in the next minutes I will explain a little bit what is released, what you can use, and what is available. So we have several clients. So first we started with the TypeScript implementation. But of course, if you want to go to small devices, to microcontrollers, TypeScript is not an option. It's way too big. That's why we have also a C implementation. And the C implementation can be used in almost every small device. So often we receive the question, yeah, why C? Why not Rust? Or any other cool language. The answer is, at the moment at least, very simple. There, if you want to go to the embedded world, to small microcontrollers, there is C and nothing else. Now, if you want to get included in current firmwares, you need to be C. So, as I said, we have the TypeScript client, the C client, and the Node software is written in TypeScript, which is running on a server there, this is not a problem. Yeah, in or because we wanted to release a stable version of our software, we had a security audit. We have done it with consensus last year. We did discover a lot of interesting things we could enhance in our protocol. Everything is now solved and finished, so you can also, if you want to dig a little bit more inside the audit, it's published, everyone can look at it. So these are some fun facts about the Incubed implementation. Yeah, for instance, we have about 50,000 lines of code in TypeScript and even some more lines in C. In C, it is more because we had to implement our EVM by ourselves. And it's the smallest EVM which is at the moment available. It's only 300K, which you need for the complete EVM, the complete implementation. Yeah, then we did a lot of testing code. We have thousands of tests. We have a lot of documentation there. There are some smart contracts. So the first smart contract we wrote for the legacy was quite small. But yeah, during the development, we discovered a lot of attack vectors, so that's why it grew a little bit, but it's not that big at the moment anyway. Some statistics. So when you think about a standard line like Geth or Parity, you have of course a big executable, which is fine for computers, but not for small devices. Then our Incubed TypeScript version, it's about 2.5 megabytes. That's not small, but also not too big. But our C versions, they are compared to this very small, or only some 100 kilobytes. If you look at this, the C nano, the smallest version, which only can interact with or can validate transaction receipts, it's about 150k. But this number actually is not the correct number because there is the full image for this microcontroller in it, all the drivers, everything what you need. So only the software for the client is less than 100k. But if you want to have the EVM inside, then it's about 250, 300k. Yeah, size matters. This is what I said. So we have 300k, which is the complete implementation. The RAM usage is about 100k. At the moment, we are looking to get it a little bit smaller because there are some devices from companies we are working with. They say, okay, we have only 64K. Can you fit it into this? Let's see. So the biggest thing for the RAM usage is the result. Now, if I interact with a smart contract, which has a lot of code, then I need to store this in the RAM. That's maybe a problem. But if I have a specified device, then I can make a special code that it's way smaller than this. And also the payload is very, very small amount of data. I only get the result, the block header information, and a little bit the information I need additional for the Merkle proof. That's depending on the information I receive. Yeah, what is available now? So we have in the C client some transfer protocols. You can use curl for normally. Then we also have a Bluetooth protocols, NFC we are doing next time, that you also can use near field communication. Yeah, also other protocols, as we heard, could be used there to do the transport layer. Yeah, then we have the verifiers for different types of blockchains. At the moment, Ethereum protocol is completely fully implemented. We are working on the Bitcoin. IPFS is also almost done. And we are also looking into other blockchain implementations. So ETH 2.0 is on our list, also Polkadot and other networks, so that we can use our client also for these networks. Yeah, and we have some wrappers to other languages, because C, of course, not everyone wants to do his programming in C, but we have wrappers to Java, to Python, and also to WASM. So as I said, our client at the moment is only connected to, or is using a lot of libraries, so that's why it's a little bit bigger, but the WASM doesn't have any other dependencies and gets way smaller and much quicker. Yeah, this is what I said. The C library binds to a lot of different platforms. And the C is also used to generate the WASM implementation. And not every device or every platform is able to use WASM at the moment, and that's why we also have an ES-MGS implementation so that you can also use this. And when you look at the sizes, the first line is our TypeScript implementation. It's a little bit more than I said. It's about 3 megabytes. The ES-MGS is about 1 megabyte, and our WASM client is just 200k. It's very easy to embed it into your web page, into your mobile app, and so on. It's very small. As developers, of course, everyone needs documentation. So we build out of our complete software stack automatically a lot of documentations. And in read the docs, em3.readthedocs.io, you can get the complete documentation so that you can use it for your own projects. So maybe some information to the license. The complete source is licensed as HGBL so that it can be freely used in every open source project. And there's also a dual license for commercial projects, which which then can be is a sold access to so that you can buy this license if you have commercial projects where you need it and you are not able to use the HGPL license. Yeah, this is the a page from the documentation. Yeah, you can. I think it's a good documentation. You can find all the information you need to run a node and also to implement the client, use the client in your projects in this documentation. Yeah, and we also have some tools you can use and which makes it easier. There's a dashboard where you can see how this network works. So at the moment, yeah, we are running from Slogit some nodes, there are some other nodes running. Everyone who uses this protocol, of course, is invited to set up his own node, include it into the network, so that we get a real distributed, a real decentralized network where everyone can get the information he needs and also delivers information to others. We have a setup wizard also, so that it's very easy to set up such your own node, so that it's easy to participate in this network. So have a look on the time. I don't want to go too deep into programming, but give you some insights how easy it is to use Incube in your projects. So first, some slides what we are doing. So the main feature of the client is to verify the information. It gets, as I said, the information I requested and the Merkle proof which I need to verify it. Now, for instance, in the first, I have this this receipt from the transaction, so and I can have the signed block hash, so I know what is the correct hash, and then I can calculate the Merkle tree and get the information. The same applies to information in the state tree. And when I want to interact with a smart contract, then this is not enough. Then we have also to run the code, the smart contract code, in our own EVM to calculate the correct hash. And this is done. As I said, we have this small EVM so that we can do it directly in the client. Okay, how does the code look like? So this is a simple example how Java or TypeScript implementation could look like. Not just initialize the incubed client object, and then we have some APIs so you can directly access functions, you can directly access state information and so on. If you are using or building an application based on Web3.js, then it's way simpler for you. You have just to replace the HTTP provider with an Incube client instead of the existing HTTP provider, and everything works as you need it. In C, it looks also very easy. We have the same API function there, just build an Incube object or Incube struct, initialize it, define the transport layer, and then you can access the information directly. One thing I think is also a nice feature. So from the C code, we also can build a command line tool. And so with this command line tool, you can directly access from your command line information from the blockchain. You can call IN3 and then ask information to the blockchain. All the communication stuff I described is in the background, and you can access secure, validated information. So you can even include blockchain interaction or blockchain requests into your shell scripts and so on. And also to deploy something, it's very easy directly from the command line in one line. Okay.